Dear Heavenly Father, we praise you, Lord. We praise you, Father. Father, we praise you because you love us for when we dork up and make mistakes. We praise you, Father, because you are our Father. You are our Abba Father. And we just ask you, Lord, in Jesus' name, that anytime when I make a mistake or I say something that, you know, I didn't intend to say, I just pray that it just completely just flows right into a deep blue sea of forgetfulness and doesn't cause anybody any confusion, Father. And I just praise you for the email system that I'm able to make corrections and get things back in order. And covering this material at high speed, sometimes I say things and I make blunders. And anyway, I just praise you, Father, for your forgiveness. I praise you, Lord Jesus, for your forgiveness. I thank you, Father God, for the days that we are in right now. I pray in the name of Jesus, Father, that you pour out some type of an incredible anointing upon each of us so that we are able to endure the days that we are in. So many of us are in bad relationships. So many of us are in marriages that are not ideal. Some of us are in families and we feel more alone even in those families. Some of those families are full of drama. Some of them are full of fighting and strife, Father God. We live in a time that is probably more difficult for the families of the world than maybe even any period of time in the last couple of thousand years, perhaps. And these days are so difficult, so dark, so covered with sick, twisted, just awful things that when we expose ourselves to the news, so many of us, Father, just want to get away from this place. We don't want to be a part of it. It's not a matter of not wanting to serve you, Lord Jesus. We do want to serve you. We want to be ready. We want to be full of oil. We want the oil to be overflowing. We want to walk in the gifts of the Spirit, Galatians 5:22, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, kindness, faithfulness, goodness, and self-control, Father, which can be one of the hardest ones of all, for sure. And Father, we just pray in Jesus' name that you will give us all a spirit of calmness, a spirit of peace, a spirit of wisdom, a Holy Spirit gift of wisdom would be a beautiful thing. A Holy Spirit gift of faith and love would be a fantastic thing. And we ask you, Father, please, Father, we ask you in Jesus' name, we confess that we are always in a continuous state of sin. We understand that Romans 14, verse 23b says that that which is not from faith is sin. We understand, Lord Jesus, that you even admonished your own apostles, hand chosen, oh ye of little faith, and we're trying, and we want to walk in that sanctification and your anointing, your blessing. We need that supernatural touch, Father, to keep us steady, to keep our hearts and minds not leaning too far to one direction or too far to another direction, but to understand that the answer is not going to be A, B, or C, but almost always D, all of the above, or somewhere in the middle. And it's very, very difficult, Father, because we are under a deluge, a literal metaphorical Niagara fall of disinformation and confusion that's happening across the world, and it's exceedingly difficult to be able to stitch together any kind of I don't know what you want to call it, reality. So many people are standing on the word truth when sadly what they believe is not in fact the truth. And it's just a very awful time to be alive, intermingled with so much media, so much input, knowing that we've been lied to, knowing that fraud has taken place in the presidential election, and knowing just to look around us and to see how quickly this country, Babylon the Great, has sunken into the most sick, twisted condition. Yet at the same time, almost in a state of quietness, and maybe quietness before the storm. And we just give you all the praise, and we pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, that you will strengthen us. We understand that even the wise virgins fall asleep. We don't want to fall asleep. We pray in the name of Jesus with your anointing that, you know, those who wait upon the Lord, Isaiah 40:31, those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. And Father, we are asking you in the name of Jesus that you will renew each of our strength, that you will draw us in closer, that you will help us when we get off of our normal routines and the time that we'd like to spend in the secret place of the Most High, when our days or normal routines get disrupted or our jobs go haywire. Father, we just need your help. We need a supernatural, let's just call it a Delta Force SEAL Team 7 patrol of angels, Lord God, to be out ferreting out the demons of darkness and the indirect threat vectors and arresting the demons and striking them deaf, blind, and dumb and casting them into the pit. In the name of Jesus, Father, we pray for your assistance in every manner, that you encircle our dwelling places with a holy fire, that you encircle our loved ones with the holy fire, that you continue to collect our prayers in heaven in the form of incense and however they are stored in your your awesome throne room, which we all hope to be with exceeding joy in front of someday very, very soon. And Father, just save those prayers up and use them for your perfect timing, for not only for us, but also for those that we are praying for on a daily basis and our loved ones. In the name of Jesus, hold us, Father God, and strengthen us for the days that we are in right now, because we want to be at the ready. We want to continue to touch people's lives. We want to continue to live out of love. We want to be those examples that you want us to be, Jesus, and to be able to touch the hearts and the minds of those around us in such a manner that they will be drawn to us, drawn to you, Lord Jesus, through our behaviors and through our prayers. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray and thank you, Father God. And now to him, our Lord Jesus, who is able to keep us from stumbling and present us faultless before the presence of your glory, Father, with exceeding joy. And boy, do we want to come soon, Father, in the name of Jesus. Please forgive us for our sins. Please continue to shower your mercy down upon us. Please, Father, pour out your abundant manifold grace upon us. And always, Father, always place us upon our knees in an overt confession of our sins, that you would be faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. Strengthen us, Father, and just help us to walk on that narrow path with a steadiness, not be affected emotionally by the things that we see around us, and to keep that level-headedness that we need to have. We don't want to be ignorant, but at the same time, the Ecclesiastes 1:18 problem is a very big challenge for many of us, and we just pray for your peace. Jesus, you said, "Peace I give to you," and we accept it. We praise your holy name, and we ask you for more of it in the next week, which is going to be a real difficult one for a lot of us. And we just praise your holy name, and we thank you, Lord Jesus. We praise your holy name, and we thank you, Heavenly Father, for all of your mercy and grace. In Jesus' name we pray and thank you. Hallelujah. Amen.
Watch and pray. For I would come for you one day. I gave you my word so you would know the time I'd come and take you home. It's time for you to look around. The signs I gave were coming down. Don't be called to sleep and blind. You don't want to be left behind. Come and be whole. 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 Come and be holy.
All right, praise God. I'm Mr. Blunder Boy. Mr. Blunder Boy, right, kids? I'm the Blunder Boy. You know I'm the Blunder Boy. Yeah, I'm surprised you guys didn't yell at me when I was dorking up. I made my – sometimes when I'm talking really, really fast and I'm moving from one subject to the other subject, which, by the way, is like how I do everything, I say things and then I look back in retrospect and I'm like going – you know, but I'm already moved on to like four new subjects by the time I realize, and usually I don't even think of it during the show. And sometimes I'm like, oh my gosh, I can't believe you said that. And that's what happened when I was talking about the false prophets. in the New Testament. The point I was trying to make, I'm going to read to you the email that I sent out with a retraction to the people who do subscribe to the email list, which you can easily do by clicking on the red button that says, you know, for the email, you know, for the radio show emails at tribulation-now.org. I know my Bible very well. What I said was dorked up. It was wrong. Okay. It was a blunder. Wasn't it, kids? Okay. Now, So first I'm going to read the letter. I sent out an email communication to the people that are part of the list, and I said, some apologies and clarifications. God bless you all in this long weekend. I hope you're blessed and happy with your family and with the Lord. I said two things I wanted to clarify and apologize for. I will restate and revisit these subjects on the Sunday night show. So here I am. Praise God. All right. So anyway, so I said, notification of the prayer vigil. First, I am sorry that I did not send out a notification to folks about taking some vacation time this weekend. While I made the announcement on Wednesday's show, I often forget that there are people who participate in the prayer vigil that do not listen to the regular shows. I should have sent out an email and let folks know. I will make sure that I do that in the future. I am sorry about that. God bless you. Admittedly, I'm pretty overwhelmed with my day job, and I will try a little bit harder. And I think I kind of, you know, touched upon this on the last show, and I wish I wouldn't have anyway. But long story short, yeah. If there was some way I could get on a spaceship and escape this planet tonight, I'd be gone. I mean, I saw a cartoon the other day where some guy was waving like a big handful of dollar bills at a UFO going, I'll pay you to abduct me. And I, you know, sometimes I feel like that, you know, but I'm just, you know, I may have some expertise in that subject, but I have never actually seen one, or at least I don't know for sure if I have. I mean, there's a lot of light, but I live near an airport. So that's, kind of, you know, anyway, so who knows, you know? All right. Now, the next part is about the false prophet statement regarding the New Testament. I spoke that completely wrong. It was wrong. It was a blunder. It was dorked up wrong. And the only sound that I can give sound effect for that is this. Okay. Now I'm going to explain what I was trying to say, but did a crummy job of doing it. So I put this in the email. I said, second. Regarding my comment about no references of false prophets in the New Testament, sometimes when I am moving very quickly through a ton of information, I miss making my point properly and I goof up. I should have been more clear in regard to the context of my comments. We are, in fact, blessed by Jesus's new covenant of love, which, by the way, supersedes the old covenant of, hey, let's put it this way. If we followed the things in the Old Testament, then when our kids misbehaved, if we were under the law and we followed it properly, we would take our children out and we would stone them to death. Okay? Are you kind of getting the magnitude of the point I'm trying to make here? So I was trying to juxtapose to create a contrast, a dramatic contrast between the Old Testament and the New Testament. All right, this is very, very important because of the way people are behaving and stuff like that. So I go on to explain. I said, yes, now I'm talking about specific phrase, false prophet, okay? And so I go on, yes, there are exactly seven verses in the New Testament that mention false prophets explicitly, although if you put like an asterisk after it, you can find also the verses that are in Revelation and some other, you know, which of course is talking about the false prophet, which we know about that. Okay, now, but here's what I go on to explain. However, for what it's worth, my point was that these references are about extreme and intentionally misleading prophecies of people by speaking truly false things in the very end. This is very different than what we are seeing today on YouTube and through other good meaning brothers and sisters that may only be challenged by, that is, seducing spirits and things that they've been taught through their churches or heard on the internet, which of course we all know is just loaded with all kinds of things that are true, right? Okay. So then I gave some examples. I said, for example, the folks that are saying that the vaccine is mark of the beast are merely misled. They're doing their best to serve our brothers and sisters, and we need to love and pray for them and for the people that they confuse. These are not false prophets. This is just one of probably hundreds of examples that I can share. Similarly, there those who prophesied that Trump would go back into the White House are of the same group. They believe with all their heart that they are telling people what God has shown them. There is no intentional darkness involved in their prophecies. They are merely hearing from seducing spirits, which we know about from the Stanley Fraudgeon prophecy, and we're in the middle of that right now. All right, and then I go on to explain. Again, for what it's worth, I think what we are seeing today is, and I put this in all capital letters, bolded black, nothing in comparison to what we will be seeing in the near future. What people are saying on YouTube and other media sources is not intentionally destructive and intended to mislead the body of Christ, but appears to me to be laced with opinions and earthly persuasions that are not meant to hurt people and deceive to deceive us, as the scriptures that talk about false prophets in the New Testament are essentially. Okay, and so just to kind of like give you an example. Okay, and there's just so many. Now, the one example, the example that I put into the email communication that I sent out was 2 Peter 2, verses 1 through 2, where it says, quote, "But there were also false prophets amongst the people, even as there," now this is talking about even back during Jesus' time and stuff, the apostle time, "even as there were, will be, now notice this is, think about this, this will be, so he's projecting this into the future, and it doesn't seem to have an end to it, so who knows if it'll ever end. But it says, "just as there will be false teachers among you who will," now you got to really pay close attention to this point, "who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the Lord who bought them," bought them with his blood. You see where I'm heading with this? So when you look at this contextually, this is a warning about a completely – this isn't about, "yea, saith the Lord," and whoopsie-daisy, I was wrong or whatever. "Oh, you're a false prophet." No. This is talking about a whole different deal. As a matter of fact, I'm going to show you another scripture here that's going to – I think it'll knock your socks off, because it's really – the Lord showed me this just for the program. But anyway, I said, I think we will see things happen in the future, very destructive lies in the form of so-called prophecies. By the way, they're trying to release – we already know that they're trying to release a Bible that completely takes out all references to homosexuality. You can pretty much count on that happening. We also know that they're currently getting ready to release a Bible that has the United States Constitution in it, which to me is an absolute – oh, that is a naughty, naughty, pants on fire. Do not do it. But anyway, American Christians, what can I say? They think they're like the bomb. They don't realize that their own country gets judged more than any other country. The two most judged countries are Israel and the United States in the entire Bible. Although everybody else is going to be joining in the fun, believe me. It's 25% of the world, which would be the most developed countries and the war-minded countries, are going to be involved in the four seal. Okay, it says it clear as a bell. All right, praise God. Now, and then I go ahead and I end. I quoted some of the scriptures that I was trying to make the point with. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 19 says, "Do not quench the spirit, do not despise prophecies." These are just examples, okay? 1 Corinthians 13, 12 says, "For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face," which is when we're in front of Jesus. All right, so seeing through the mirror dimly, if you're prophesying, guess what? We are all seeing through the mirror dimly. All right, okay, and then you have 1 Corinthians 13, 9 through 10, where it says, "We know in part and we prophesy in part." Okay, so none of these scriptures imply that a prophet is going to slam the ball out of the park, and bat 1,000 every single time. They're not. When a person has a gift of prophecy and they're dabbling around on internet and they're listening to people, you can see it. I have never seen, you can see right now today, you can see so many things that people are saying in the name of the Lord that it's just not, anyway, so I'm not going to get into it. I'm not going to pick it apart. All I'm trying to do is help people understand the delta, the massive difference between the days of the Old Testament versus the days of the New. All right. And let me give you another example. Okay. So let's see here. I'm trying to find the one which I wanted to. I believe it was here in Luke 6:26. Okay. Okay. No, I don't know. I got to double click here. Hold on. Okay. Here we go. Listen to this. So he's in Luke Okay, he's in Luke 6, chapter 6, and he starts around verse 20. He starts basically kind of doing, you know, the Luke version of the Beatitudes. You know, blessed are you poor, for yours is the kingdom of God, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, then Jesus, at the end of that, starting in verse 24 in Luke 6, he says, but woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full, for you shall hunger. Woe to you who laugh now, for you shall mourn and weep. Woe to you when all men speak well of you, for so did their fathers to the false prophets. Now then, what's important to note is Jesus doesn't stop to take a drink of water. You know what I'm saying? He continues. This is very similar to, you know, the wise and foolish virgins, where he goes directly from the wise virgins into the parable of the talents and rewards, which strongly implies, well, very, very, very strongly implies that the talents and rewards parable is directly connected. It's being used as an example of those who are full of oil bearing fruit by being like Jesus. And by the way, the book of James talks about Christians, you know, taking care of widows, and there's, you know, scriptures all over the Bible. There's ministries associated with encouraging people. There's ministries, you know, prayer is a ministry. You know, people, you know, anyway, I've gone over this a bunch of times. The point I want to make right here, though, is really, really prolific. It is just, it jumps off the page. This is the quintessential point that I was trying to make and blundered on the last radio show. Okay. Okay. So right here, again, Jesus said, woe to you. This is verse 26 in Luke 6. He says, woe to you when all men speak well of you. For so did their fathers to the false prophets. Now note that he is calling specific groups of false prophets, not the ones that were. See, when in 1 Kings 22:19, when our Heavenly Father, when King Ahab, when the minor god, and refers to it as a spirit, but it's a minor god, is standing in this pantheon of beings in front of the Father in 1 Kings 22:19, and Micaiah sees this thing happening, and one of them steps forward, one talks to one in one way, one talks to one in the other way, and one of them comes forward to our Heavenly Father, because our Heavenly Father asks, what are we going to do to get King Ahab to go in and die at Ramoth Gilead? And one of them comes forward, they step forward, it's huge pantheon of minor gods, really, is what they were. They call them spirits because spirit bodies, right? And one of them says, I know, I will go down and become a lying spirit in the mouth of all of his prophets. And our Heavenly Father says, you shall, and you will be successful. And that is how they went in and got King Ahab to do. Because those prophets, before that minor god got permission from our Heavenly Father to go down and become a lying spirit in the mouth of the prophets for King Ahab, King Ahab did not have false prophets around him at the time. Okay? Those gods were, that particular God said, I will go down and become a lying spirit in the mouth of his prophets. That is a seducing spirit. And that is the kind of stuff that we see happening today. Now, let me just go back to Luke 6 and clear that, because I want you to see this. This is huge. This is so huge. All right. So Jesus, he's talking about, he does the whole, you know, Matthew 5, you know, blessed are, you know, but it's the Luke 6 rendition, you know, blessed when men hate you. He's telling you how to behave. He's telling you to be loving, kind, meek, long-suffering, all that kind of stuff, just like he does in the Beatitudes. All right, now, and then he goes in and he gives out these woes for people who are naughty. And then he uses an example. So did their fathers, you know, speaking about, you know, woe to you when all men speak well of you, for so did their fathers to the, quote, false prophets. So he's speaking about specific groups of false prophets. Okay, in the Old Testament, that is his reference. But listen, before he doesn't stop. He doesn't go walking down to Bethesda. He doesn't go on a three-day Sabbath journey. You know, he just keeps on talking. And the very next thing he says is, but I say to you who hear, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who spitefully use you. To him who strikes you on one cheek, offer the other. And from him who takes away your cloak, withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who asks of you. And from him who takes away your goods, do not ask for them back. as just and just as you want men to do to you, you also do to them likewise. See, he uses the Old Testament behaviors and says, whoa, 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 whoa. And then he says, but you, I'm looking at you. I am giving you commandments of how you are supposed to behave. And that is the contrast I was trying to make, but I blundered it and said there was no references to false prophets. There are, but not in the context of the way they're referred to in the Old Testament. So again, yes, we are warned by Jesus that false Christ and false prophets will rise and show great signs and wonders to deceive even the elect if it were possible in Matthew 24:24, which, by the way, is pretty far down the road, at least it appears to me, unless things jettison fast, because we still haven't even hit the third seal global financial collapse, and we certainly are not through the the Olivet discourse events yet. Okay, so and then you'll have, beware of false prophets. Look, it even goes into the fruits. Listen to this, Matthew 7:15: beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. Now think about that analogy. Okay? This isn't the people that are standing on the side of the road holding up a sign going, you're getting vaccinated, it's the mark of the beast. Or people that are out on YouTube right now, one of which we even had on the radio show, very sweet lady, but she was absolutely convinced that the Lord told her Donald Trump was going back into the presidency. Okay? Listen, it says you will know them by their fruits. Okay. All right. So it's ravenous wolves. Think about it. Inwardly, they are ravenous wolves. These are not ravenous wolves people out there right now. All right. So anyway, I wanted to clear that up. Sorry for the blunder. Thank you, kids, for being so kind. Sorry for the blunder. Hopefully you signed up or will sign up for the email so that if I do blunder, like usual, I'll be able to send out an email and make a correction. And also for those of you who don't like to listen to the Wednesdays or the Sunday shows because, whatever, they're too long or you don't want to break them into pieces, whatever the case is, you don't have a podcast app or whatever, I understand that. I totally do. But I can't get out the amount of information and do the guest unless, so I'm trying to cut the shows down to 2 hours as best I can. But time flies. And the last program we ran, that was the first time in the history of the program that I know of that we did 3.5 hours. Now, in the earlier days, we may have. But really, when we started back out in 2011, we were only doing 2-hour programs and we were cutting it tight. I mean, we were just like shutting her down, but we did. It was just a different dynamic. But anyway, and so that was a very long show, and there was a lot of really, really important information in that program, except for my blunder, is vital. Because if you don't understand that what I shared with everybody on that program in the last half of the show about what we are to be looking forward to, if you don't have that like written up on a whiteboard in your house with like little check boxes, then you're going to be bouncing off the walls. Anybody out there, look, the COVID thing, this breaks my heart. I do not want to fly again. All they're doing is punching each other out, turning planes around. It's miserable. It was horrible flying before. It's going to be 10 times more horrible flying. I hope and I pray in Jesus' name, please, Father, have mercy on me. And maybe I can, not have to travel for a while. I don't know. I hope I can never travel again, quite frankly. But unfortunately, I kind of fell into this career. It wasn't like I sat back and said, gee, I'd like a traveling job and I want to do this for a living. It had nothing to do with this. I started this work 26 years ago. It was a completely different profession back then, nothing like it is now, and I'm kind of stuck with it. So anyway, it is what it is. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And it does, it has some advantages and allows me to do wonderful things for Christ, and I love that. I love that. Praise God. Anyway, so I wanted to get that out, help people to understand these things. Why I misspoke and said what I said and what my intent was, what the message was that I was trying to get across, because there are people out there, as we know, that are out there calling people names, and they shouldn't ought to be doing that, because you heard Jesus' admonishment. Immediately he's like, you're supposed to be loving for them. You're supposed to be praying for them. This is who you are. And these are the messages that the vast majority of Christians out there are missing. If we are not just like Jesus in every possible way, and I know we're all struggling with something. There's something. Anybody out there think they're perfect? I can tell you, I have met pastors that actually did believe they were. I mean, they actually believed that they didn't have any sin in their lives. And the very things that they were saying to me at the time that they were saying it, I was thinking to myself, that's a sin. The very fact that you're saying what you're saying is a sin. But of course, I'm not going to get into a debate with them. And so I just kind of let it go. I tried to use a very kind example, and I used some different colored leaves on the ground to show, you know, but sometimes people receive and sometimes people don't. A man convinced against his will is of the same opinion still. Once they decide that the earth is a triangle shape, they're going to stick with it because they want to believe that the world is triangular in shape. And that's just how it is. Never mind that there were trillions of planets out there that are not triangular in shape. It just so happens this earth is a triangle or whatever. I mean, you know, the problem is that, you know, people will say things like, well, the flag was blowing in the wind. You know, when they were doing the NASA stuff, that was all blah, blah. There's what's known as a solar wind. It's called the heliosphere. It's a particle-driven, kind of an electromagnetic. But the problem is the people that think things that they should not have think, they tend to not be very scientifically minded. They can even, in some cases, I've run across this, where they have advanced scientific degrees, but they still fall for the Illuminati psyop. And once you fall for the Illuminati psyop, your credibility is gone. And once your credibility is gone, guess what? Getting it back is almost impossible. And all the work that you do, everything that you do from that day henceforth, everybody's going to go, oh yeah, that's the guy who, believes blah, 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 blah. So it comes with it kind of like a reputation. Now, listen, I suffer from this myself. I understand these dynamics, and there have been many, many, many people who I've told this a zillion times. I don't even know what a zillion means. That's my way of saying I cannot quantify it. Thank you, Jesus. A bazillion. But, hallelujah. So the point is that, you come to a point where, you know, going back to a man convinced against his will is of the same opinion. So let me just cycle back and get back on track. The point is that you come to a point where you just have to kind of let it go. And I've had, I don't even know how many bazillions of people come back to me years. Sometimes it would take them 2 to 3 years. I would remember their emails because they would email me, you know, at jbaptist777@gmail.com. Now, there for a while, I was under a lot of attack. But nowadays, I guess not so surprisingly, so many people have awakened to the creepy weirdness. There's enough people who have seen that strange neck anomaly on Fauci in the video that are freaking out. People are freaking out. TikTok, in the weirdness of that world, which I want nothing to do with personally, is actually, because it's 60-second limits and people can just press it, it's very, very hyper fast, you know, that kind of thing. There's a lot of stuff people are catching in TikTok. Now, you know, it is tempting because I do like to stay on top of things to want to put it on my, but I don't want to. I'm going to avoid it. But, there are now people that are heavily addicted to TikTok, which I want nothing to do with anything that's addictive. Forget that. I get, you know, too much going on. I got my own problems. Okay. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Run for the hills. Okay. So anyway, but because of the fact that a person can, you know, if they're a TikTok type of person and they're driving down the road on a dark street in the middle of nowhere, whatever, you know, and they're catching things, okay? I am getting – people are sending me TikTok videos, and I look – you know, I don't – through the app. I just look at it through the website, and wow. Okay, so there are – people are starting to catch beings that otherwise they would not have been able to convince anybody existed. Okay, so there was the one TikTok video that where an individual seemed to catch what was believed to be a skinwalker. I think that was probably highly accurate. That was also put on, Coast to Coast AM. I don't know what it looked like it was. And the only reason I say that is because there was a movie about them, and it really did look, it's very creepy. I have seen over the years, Because of my deep dive research over the last 13, 14 years of the otherworldly being phenomenon, we'll just call it that, and also some of them are indigenous. I was studying the book of Genesis, going through, you know, after you get lots of learning over years and years and years of time, you start going back through the Old Testament, and boy, you know, folks, talk about bad translations and stuff. I mean, it just jumps off the page. I mean, if you understand, you know, what the word Elohim actually means, Elohim, and, you know, then it gets translated into God, but it's not God because it's supposed to be Lord God Yahweh Elohim, which is completely different than just Elohim. And most people don't understand these dynamics. And so the early translators just simply said God. God, 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 God. Same thing with the serpent. The serpent, the word serpent is used like everywhere, but it's not always that. Sometimes it's Nakash, N-A-C-H-A-S-H. Michael Heiser does a wonderful white paper on that subject, which is absolutely fabulous. So, but the genericness of, I don't even know if that's a word, but the generic use of the word spirit. That's another thing that throws people for a loop. Okay, it's just we're not really getting an accurate view of what the Old Testament is really trying to tell us is going on. When, you know, the host of heaven, heavily misunderstood. Okay, heavily misunderstood. Anyway, you can go. There's just endless scriptures that we could review and look at and take a third. But I'm going through it again, and it's fascinating because even when you look at the flood event, you notice that the Lord, when he's talking about bringing the flood upon the earth, he uses the term flesh. I'm going to destroy all flesh, 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 flesh. I noticed that he didn't say I'm going to wipe out all life or all life forms. And isn't it fascinating that Jesus said that we are to preach the gospel to every living creature, knowing that there are going to be tares on the earth and we wouldn't be able to tell the difference. All right. So you just preach. Now, where am I heading with this? I've always wondered with the flood, you know, and the language in Genesis, I've always wondered to myself, well, how did these reptilian beings, you know, get underground? How, you know, the Nakash and all these entities, and what about, you know, Middle Earth and all this? You know, I thought Genesis was basically saying it wiped all life forms off the earth, but in reality, it does not say that. It uses heavily, it even refers to the animals as flesh and creeping things, and so, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now, it doesn't say anything about bringing on mosquitoes, so who knows, you know, what's up with the bugs. But you know, it does use the word kind, and that word kind implies it could be many, many different species, okay, which is, you know, explains a lot. All right, so anyway, but I was taking a second look at that, and it's amazing. So what I've decided is this time, using my olive tree, I love my olive tree software, because when you are studying from your Android phone, if you very, very carefully touch just the verse number, and you highlight that verse with a particular color, and you have like about eight different, you know, I don't know, maybe six, seven different colors. When you hide, and you can, you know, in your mind, you can say, well, if it's purple, it's a mystery. It's a Bible mystery. So I've chosen the color purple as a Bible mystery. So every time I saw the word flesh, boom, purple. Flash, boom, purple, flash, boom, purple. And I'm going through looking for these Bible mysteries because now I've been awakened to a lot of these things. And I wondered to myself, you know, if God wiped out all life from planet Earth, then how could any of these beings have survived it, right? Well, the thing is, in the book of Jude, it calls these beings twice dead, strange flesh, which implies not normal flesh, right? So, yeah, it's amazing how many mysteries in the Bible there are. There are probably bazillions of that new word. Actually, that's an old word, bazillion. But there, I think the Bible, to J. Vernon McGee's point, is so gushing and overflowing with Bible mysteries and things that people do not understand that help us to understand how big this is, how enormous our existence actually is. I used to think it was demeaning. I was like, well, wait a minute. I thought we were the sons of God, you know, and I was like, you know, but then when you apply who we are in the universes, then it just takes on a hold, and it's like Jesus and we're going to rule and reign with him, and all of a sudden that changes the dynamic. It really expands the excitement and trivializes the tribulation ugliness that we have to go through here on the earth. That makes dealing with the ugly a lot more tolerable. Let's just put it that way. Praise God. And gives us even more of a reason to punch our way through the things that tempt us. You know, we're all tempted, you know, believe me, we are some more than others. You know, even in 1 Peter 1:9, it says that husbands and wives, in so many words, and I'm paraphrasing, you have to go read it yourself, 1 Peter 1:9, that when husbands and wives are not getting along together, that your prayers are hindered. You know that? See, these are the kinds of things I'm going to use the purple color for. I love the color purple. I want to know all the mysteries in the Bible, all of them. I want to know them all. That's why I'm going back to the beginning and working my way through the Old Testament. Now, some of the Old Testament, I have to admit, is a little bit hard for me to choke down because it's like, you know, it's judgment after judgment after judgment after judgment after judgment said about 7,000 different ways to Sunday. And some of it's a lot of, like, kind of highly repetitive and stuff. But there are gems, and that's the thing. Like the book of Job is a tough read for anybody. I mean, it is just a tough read. But, man, the mysteries in the book of Job. It's almost like our Heavenly Father, which you see in Proverbs 25:2. It says, it's the glory of God to conceal it the matter and glory of kings to search out a matter. You know, so that kind of implies that when you're searching for the mysteries that are in the Bible and you're hungry for them, that there's, you know, kind of like a blessing, like a reward in heaven for those who take on that pursuit. Now, it's amazing. It's amazing when your eyes are open and you take another look and your vocabulary, when you realize that, you know, there are trillions of life forms, when you realize that there are multiple universes, when you realize how big this all is, and you go back and you take another look, and it is like, oh my goodness, this is amazing. Hallelujah. So it will, you know, I remember when I first started to realize where this whole, you know, otherworldly being thing fit, and I was able to map it back to the Bible. My eyes were awakened, and then it was like there were entire chapters of the Bible, and then the Apocrypha. Oh my goodness! I mean, just the 14 books of the Apocrypha that were included in the original 1611 King James. There's references to alien invasions in there. Okay, so anyway, and we know, you know, the day of the Lord is just absolutely. It's someday I ought to just do maybe just a special show. Maybe the next one I do by myself, I may just do it on the 3 days of darkness. People are fascinated by that. I pray in Jesus' name that we are not here. I pray that we make the barley harvest. I pray that we, you know, get closer to our Father. We walk in the fruits of the Spirit. We get better self-control emotionally. We don't get depressed and we fight it. We break strongholds that are, and we pray hard for the renewing of our mind, and we learn, you know, and, you know, it's hard, you know, when you chug down, you know, a bottle of red pill, you know, Kool-Aid or whatever you want to call it, or, you know, eight, like, you know, who knows how many bottles of red pills, which, you know, and you've been kicked off, you know, King Moonraiser kicked you off the island of Misfit Toys because it was like, dude, you're worse than Misfit Toy. Get off here. Okay. When you're in that place, you know, that's a tough walk because you see things. And then I have to admit, for me, I just want to escape. I mean, honest to goodness, sometimes I got to watch. I think tomorrow I'm going to set aside some time after I do some yard work. It's going to be a boring day tomorrow for me. But I'm kind of thinking I'm going to go back and watch Astronaut Farmer again. Right, kids? Astronaut Farmer, one of your favorites. All right, on that note, let's go ahead and hit the news so we can bring on Sister Laurie Ditto again tonight. What a blessing. This is exciting because this is going to be very focused on the things that she saw when she was shown heaven. Praise God, we need that. All right, first the news, and there's not an awful lot that's a big surprise, but enough to hit. All right, praise Jesus, let's do it.
Ladies and gentlemen, have your attention, please?
It's not normal.
It's just wrong.
It's not normal.
This is disturbing.
Game over.
Praise God. Breitbart reports that Hillary Clinton spreads fake news. Here we go again. You're fake news. You're fake news. No, you're fake. You're fake. No, you're fake. No, that segment was fake. The thing that you said yesterday was fake. Fake, 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 fake. It's like that cartoon where the dogs are looking kind of bummed out because their owner is giving them just like a small amount in their dog dish. And he's like pointing to the thing saying, you're only supposed to get like a cup. It says right here on the doggy food, you know, label. And the dogs are going like, fake news, fake news. Anyway, it says angry mob at Capitol Hill killed a policeman. She says this 9 foot tall Draco reptilian. Thank you very much, Dr. Deagle, with your very anointed gift of discernment and being able to see that when you shook her hand. Creepy. Anyway, praise God. All right. Next one up. Hallelujah. Benjamin Netanyahu, the longest-running Israeli prime minister, could be ousted in days after rivals agree to work on a unity government. And then there's from Axios.com, which is an up-and-coming and exceedingly popular web-based news source. I'm not saying they're not full of fake news, too, because I don't trust any of that. You got to sort through it. See, that's the thing. You've got to correlate. Just like we were doing with the prophecies on the last show, you have to correlate them. That's how you confirm them. And then if you have Twitter or, you know, especially see, the thing is, everybody in the world is a walking media outlet right now. So when somebody says that something really, really bad happened in such and such a country, you can just type it into Twitter and you can see if it happened because you're going to see the video. So that's how you cross-correlate the data, and that's how you confirm it. All right. This is from Axios. It says Bennett to announce that he's joining opposition to form new Israeli government and oust Netanyahu. Now, the only reason I'm bringing this up as interesting is that should Netanyahu get ousted and another government go into place, because Netanyahu is known as, well, kind of a hard butt, if you know what I mean. Right, kids? You know. When you put somebody else in there that doesn't have like a decade to two decade long reputation of going in and open up a can of whoop-hiney on you when you launch missiles, guess what happens? Yeah, this could be a sign of moving rapidly into the Gog and Magog. And if the correlation, if the assumptions, now these are, you know, you have to have a certain amount of assumptions, estimations, but if the correlation of 2024, Trump possibly re-entering the presidency, some of the prophecies that indicated that something bad could happen, which would jettison us into that Civil War event that was seen by many people, Wilkerson, et cetera, if that stuff does happen, and by the way, there's other correlating prophecies that indicate that is going to be right around the time, as I showed you on the last program, that things get really bad really fast, e.g. World War III. See, you seeing how things are sort of lining up a little bit? I don't know. We're just going to have to wait and see. I don't want to hang out here till 2024. I'm going to tell you that straight up. I pray every single day for extra help from the Lord, extra grace from the Lord, because, you know, folks, it is no fun being me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. But that's okay. I have to get my ducks in a row and you know, just learn to deal. All right. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Next one up. Praise God. Companies can make employees take COVID-19 vaccine, the EEOC says. Now, this is bad news because the EEOC is they're the Equal Opportunity Employment Commission, and these are the people that all the employers are afraid of. When you're a protected class, They're scared that you are going to sue them under the EEOC protections. However, according to this report, the EEOC has announced that corporations can legally force their employees to take the vaccine. I told people on this program several months ago they're going to tighten it up and raise the bar more and more and more. It's evil. It's seething evil. And people are out there, you know, and that's fine. You know, everybody's let every man seek his own salvation with fear and trembling. Praise Jesus. All right. Hey, I just got a text communication from our guest. And our guests don't always understand how the show works. So I've got to stop and double check this communication. Hold on just a second. Uh-oh, she actually called me on the phone. Okay, which of course that wouldn't work out very well. Okay, hold on just a second. I think I must call the number. Thanks, bye-bye. Oh, yeah. That is true. I wonder if I can send her a text to confirm it. And I can't from this app. Dagnab. I can't from this app. She said, "Hey, John, it's Lori. I think I must have called the number. Wait a minute. Okay, so in the name of Jesus, how can I get to where I need to send her a message? Because I don't have that number programmed. Let me see if this will help me. Nope. No way to do it. Not from this app. Okay, add to contacts. I can try that. Create a new contact. Isn't this fun doing it live on the air? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord. Laurie. Praise God. Ditto. And I hit save. And now, wouldn't you know it? Thank you, Jesus. Okay, I'm going to try to text her, assuming that that was a mobile phone. Yes. PSE call the show at, and the number is 319, 527, and there it is. And I just hit send. So hopefully that was a cell phone and not a landline, or else that'll just go off into la-la land. All right, and praise God, and she'll probably call any second now. So I got to go faster, go faster. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Right, kids? Oh. All right. She says she's waiting online, so praise God. Only a few more headlines to get out, and then we'll jump over to Sister Lori. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. All right, next up. Concert tickets are $18 if you're vaccinated. They are $1,000. If you're not, and you're saying, no way, Johnny, come on. No. This is WorldNet Daily, and this is the concert promoter in Florida. Yeah. Isn't that something? Mm-hmm. I'm telling you, folks, watch out. All right, praise God. Next thing up, WorldNet Daily again reports, survey shows church closings outnumber openings. Now, what they're really referring to here is that basically it's saying more Protestant churches across America that are closing than opening. So basically, I believe what they're inferring here is that the pandemic and the resulting impact on a lot of the church organizations out there has been pretty devastating. WorldNet Daily does tend to be a very Christian-leaning source of information, and to the best of my research, very accurate. So this is kind of bad news, but we saw it coming, and it was prophesied by J. Vernon McGee back in the late 50s, early 60s, that we would come upon a time where the church would move into individuals' homes, okay, essentially go underground. All right, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. All right, which, by the way, was how the early church was, and is how the Amish operate today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. All right, next one up. WorldNet Daily, watch BLM co-founder explicitly call for the end of Israel. This lady's name is Patrice colors. And she's, And then the head, one of the head people, some kind of like director or something for BLM out of, I think it was the Chicago area, he came forward and said, boy, when I really figured out what these people were about, I quit. And that's all over the news too. So, you know, no surprise to those of us who are awake and aware. Praise God. And yes, astronaut farmer is the answer. So whoever builds the first spaceship, just make sure you make a lot of room for as many of us to get off this planet as we can. All right. Hallelujah. All right. Daily Mail. Listen to this. Post-pandemic, New York City is laid bare as homelessness, mental illness, and crime escalate. Rattled locals and tourists alike believe the town has, quote, lost its essence, while city cheerleaders insist the ship has turned. Now, of course, the city cheerleaders, they're trying to, you know, breathe life back into it. But there's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 really bad news bullet points, which I'm not going to read, about the demise of New York City. All right. Now, you may say, who cares, and that kind of thing. And I understand where you're coming from. You know, I'm a tree hugger. I wish I lived in Gatlinburg and I could just go up in the mountains all the time and all that kind of thing. You know, not to mention that it's like, you know, Pigeon Forge is like the only place in the world where you can drive down the street and actually see Jesus signs on people's stores, which I think is very cool. But anyway, but it's kind of sad. I mean, I know that it's like seems to be the epicenter, but no, the epicenter of filthiness is the whole country. I'm sorry, but that's just how it is. All right, now we will go on and hit this one real quick. I want to move quick. Thousands participate in anti-Bolsonaro demonstrations held across Brazil. So you've got Brazil. I'm talking about humongous crowds that make the, you know, the Obama inauguration look like three little girls having a tea party. These are unbelievable. As far as the eyes can see, this is Brazil. It is also happening in Colombia. There are incredible riots, but massive protests all over the world. The only country that seems to not have any is us. Somebody even wrote me an email, or they made a mention on Facebook, and I had to crack up. The person goes, it must be the fluoride in the water. There's a lot of truth to that, by the way. And don't get me going on the NASA craft that were launched and were actually pumping lithium gases into the air. But anyway, you know, pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. Next up. United States is monitoring Iranian warships that may be heading to Venezuela. By the way, them's fighting words, although guess what? We got Biden. and who's telling Biden what to do? Obama. So anybody out there is not hearing Gomer Pyle go, surprise, 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 in the back of their ear? Come on. All right, next one up. Listen to this. LGBT activist reveals moments, the agenda, the movement's agenda. So they're out in the open. They're very out in the open. They're very outspoken. And this, I'm not going to read you a whole article, but listen to this. Their movement's agenda is to teach kids kink while destroying family values. And I'm not going to get into some of the things that they are actually teaching children. They are disgusting. Kind of puts a big old showstopper in the, you know, Seven Mountains mandate stuff. Anyway, next one up. Virginia gym teacher placed on leave after refusing to say that biological boy can be a girl. He was told that at a board meeting, and he actually said, I am a teacher, but I serve God first, and I will not affirm that a biological boy can be a girl and vice versa because it is against my religion. You're fired. Imagine that. Imagine he's probably still paying off his college debt. Next up. WorldNet Daily. More states offering return to work bonuses as businesses struggle to hire workers. So now, instead of sending people thousands of dollars to stay home, and listen, I totally the situation is bad. It is very real. I feel horrible about the things that are happening in different parts of the world still, even today. I lost a close relative to it and a best friend. Okay, I get it. You know, it's not one or the other. It's both. It's always all of the above. Okay. And they do manipulate the numbers to their agenda. That is how it works. But it's always both. It's always real, but it's also exaggerated. It's not one or the other. It's all of the above, always. That's because these entities are working for Satan, and Satan is not an idiot. That's why we need to be wise as serpents and gentle as doves. All right, praise God. Next up, Department of Homeland Security chief says, we're looking very closely at putting in a vaccine passport for the United States of America. Wait a minute. I thought Biden said otherwise. Watch what happens. Next up, New York Post. Fauci facing calls for resignation after shifting. I wonder if that was an intentional use of the word shifting. Positions on probe of the Wuhan lab. He's playing, folks. He has no intention of following up on that. This is Michael Jackson. We're just watching them doing a choreograph. Listen, right after that, within days, China comes forward and says, wait a minute, you're going to look into the Wuhan lab? Well, then you need to look at Fort Detrick, because that's where it originated, which, by the way, is exactly what Judy Mikovits revealed. But anyway, they're not going to look into it, because if they really did a proper third-party probe into where it came from, guess who it's going to point to? My mom used to say, the fox is to find her, the stink lay behind her. Okay. All right. Hallelujah. All right. And then the World Health Organization just came out and said I'll give you a quote. World Health Organization's emergencies chief calls for an end to the disturbing discourse around the probe into the pandemic origins. See what they're doing? It's just they're playing. They're playing us all. It's all anti-government protesters in Bogota, Colombia. Huge protests, folks. Unbelievable. More mutants of the coronavirus. More mutants. The people in India, now they have black fungus. They have yellow fungus. They have white fungus. Folks, when they get this, they actually have to cut their entire lower jaw off of their head. So, praise God, some organizations, we'll just say, here in the United States are sending over hundreds of thousands of special, I don't know, some kind of special antibiotic or something that will help them get a grip on these funguses. Because the funguses are more horrible than the COVID in some cases. All right, listen, also, remember we had Sammy on and we were talking about Gomatown? Gomatown situation is very bad. Another volcano is popping off in Gomatown, and now the people are starving to death. They're having to leave Gomatown, okay, because they're running from this Urugango volcano, and now they have no food, no water, and they're just walking down the street. This is bad. This is really bad. We need to pray. And also, there's another big old asteroid heading directly toward us. It's about the size of the Eiffel Tower. What do you think? Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. And on that note, let's go ahead and bring on Sister Laurie Ditto. Praise God. And we're only 7 minutes behind. That's not too bad. All right, here we go. Hallelujah. Praise God. Sister Laurie, are you there?
I am. Can you hear me?
You sound great. I am going to disappear into the background like the last time and just let you take the mic, because people want to hear this amazing, well, about the book and the visions and just encouragement. People just, you know, we're living in some pretty icky times right now, and that's putting it lightly. So anyway, praise God for your testimony. Thank you for joining us tonight.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So my first book that I got to come on the show and talk about is The Hell Conspiracy. And inside of The Hell Conspiracy book, the first chapter is about heaven. And the last chapter is probably the most powerful vision of heaven I've ever had. And I never want to leave a part out of that vision. So since then, the Lord has given me permission to tell 15 other heaven visions. So in total, I talk about 17 heaven visions. And people ask, you know, how many times have you been to heaven? Well, I've been to heaven many times. You know, John, that doesn't make me special. It just makes me responsible for what it is that God is
well
showing
said.
Me. And I, yeah, thanks. You know, I believe I go to heaven for the purpose of the scripture that says, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so I grew up, I was a Catholic kid growing up and used to pray my rosary. And I have prayed the Lord's Prayer so many times. And every time I pray it, I find great strength in it and real comfort. And I've often wondered about the scripture, you know, how thy kingdom come. Lord, we don't even know what it looks like. And from the time I was little, I remember thinking, we don't know what heaven looks like. And now older, you know, we want to implement the principles that are in heaven on the earth so that we can receive those benefits. However, if we don't know what those principles are, then we just kind of, it's the blind leading the blind. It's like, you know, we're just in muck and mire until we can come up higher to the principles that's in heaven. And so that's why I believe I'm taken to heaven. And and I really think, John, that of all of the times that I have been to heaven, I know this sounds a little crazy, but I believe I've been to heaven, and it's in heaven, it's only one day. I've only been to heaven in one day, even though my first vision of heaven was back in 2000 until today. So you figure 21 years of seeing different things in heaven and going back and the vision being extended so that I can see more of what I didn't understand at the time. You know, it took the living word. It actually took me reading scripture and finding out what's there for God to be able to put inside of me things. And so all that to say, why do I get to go to heaven? And it isn't because I'm special. It's because I really think that if we could implement our lives and live our lives the way that they were meant to be, the way that heaven would have us live, then we can live our lives like we live in heaven and receive those benefits. Hallelujah. So probably one of the most asked questions that I get about heaven is what happens there? What's it like there? And I'm not saying that I've got it all nailed down. I can only tell about the things that I see in heaven. And I categorized it for myself. So I would say I have seen three categories of things that we will do in heaven. The first category of things is that there's a lot of family time in heaven. And it's not going to be like it is on the earth, you know. So I live in Kansas City. There's a lot of people in Kansas City I have never met. I don't know anything about them. But in heaven, that will not be the case. In heaven, I will know all of the people in heaven. I mean, I'm going to know them, and I'm going to love them. And so to get there, we need to spend a lot of family time, and we do. We get together, we play, we hang out, we visit, we do picnics. We go to each other's celebrations. There's ways for us in heaven to, I'm going to get to watch John's second birthday, and we're going to get to see what was God doing behind the scenes. How was he making you who he's always wanted you to be? And you're going to get to watch my second birthday. We're going to get to watch everybody's second birthday. And throughout eternity, we will become a very close-knit and loving family. So, like I said, there's picnics and parades, and there's an amusement park that we go to, and just fun and games, and we'll have so much fun together in heaven. We like to go swimming, and a unique thing about swimming in heaven is that when you get out of the water, you're dry, because We don't do that to the water in heaven. We don't take it around everywhere. Water stays in the lake, and we come up out of the lake and go back to our picnic and playing and that kind of thing. So, you know, things are very different in heaven. So first is a lot of family time. The second category that I'm going to talk about as far as what I've seen people do in heaven is learning. So you're not done learning. The first thing that we are going to learn when we get to heaven is the Word of God according to God. And I think it's going to shock us how much stuff we thought we knew, but Jesus is going to tell us what is the truth. And so there's no shortcuts. We all need to know the Word of God. It's that important, that pieces of eternity, so that we will know God, understand God. We will have living understanding of the Word of God, and the mysteries will be revealed to us. And so that's really fun. When I was in heaven, I saw Father Abraham. You know, as far as celebrities go, he really is a celebrity in heaven. And he was teaching the children. There were lots of little ones around him. And it was fun because they were singing him a song. I don't know the song, but they had told him he has his own song. And so they started singing. And maybe you know it. It goes, Father Abraham had many sons. And they were dancing and clapping. And he was happy. And so he was teaching principles of one another, you know, loving one another, and a whole bunch of one another's that are in the Bible. He was explaining those to the children. So that was really exciting to know. And all of us, so you think about a new believer, maybe they become a new believer close to the time of their second birthday when they get to go to heaven. They don't know much about the Word of God. It's okay. They will know the Word of God in heaven, and so will we. And so, you know, if you want to test out of some of the beginner classes, you can do that by knowing the Word of God now. So, you know, there are no shortcuts with God, and there's many aspects that the Word of God will teach us if we take time. So that's aspect number two of heaven that I saw. And the third thing in heaven that I saw, the categorizing it, is, you know, our Father in heaven is a creator, and he made us a creator, to be able to create. And in heaven, people are very creative. They take time and they make beautiful things. And that was very, I'm very happy about that because, you know, Lord has kind of, when I was young, you think about a funnel, I was real wide, like at the top. But now my life has become more like a laser, and I'm coming through that narrow part of a funnel. And all my time is dedicated to helping people know Jesus. That's the majority of what it is that God wants me to do with my time. And one day I was just complaining, you know, because in heaven people, they can do everything. I mean, we'll have all eternity to learn how to do everything. And I wanted to learn to play the piano. And something that the Father said to me was to stay in my lane, meaning complete what it was that I've been given to do. And someday when I get to heaven, there'll be time. He will teach me, someone will teach me how to play the piano, and we will create. So while I was there, I went into shops, like you think of downtown little shops. And our friends, our brothers and sisters, they will have these little shops where they've created pottery or pictures. And they're very different than here. They're more alive. And you'll walk in and see one, and your friends, your family will be so excited that you appreciate their work that they give you these treasures to take home. In our homes, Our mansions are filled with all different types of treasures. So anyway, those are the three things that we do in heaven, and I just can't wait for all of us to get there. That's really important that we think about all of us when we think about heaven. And right now, the world, Satan is lying to so much of the world that we've really got to figure out how to bring people closer to God. But maybe what I can do right now is I think I'd like to just tell us about a vision, some of the visions that I've seen about heaven, and maybe that can help us figure out our life, you know, how to live. So one of my favorite things to talk about is the bridal march. And it's like, what in the world is that? Well, maybe you didn't realize that once you got saved, you're actually walking a bridal march. You are the bride of Christ, and you're walking towards the wedding of the Lamb. And while you're walking towards Jesus, his eyes are on you. And anything that you ask in his name, he'll give you those things as like a wedding gift. And so for heaven, it's a short amount of time, even though on earth we have more time. And this vision, when it opened, I was underneath a whole lot of circumstances. And I really couldn't concentrate on much of anything other than pain and the strain that was on my back. And I heard the voice of the Lord, and he wanted to know where I was. And so we asked that, where is she? And my angel answered, I believe we all have an angel, some people more than one angel, to help them accomplish the task that Jesus has for us to do. But my angel answered and told the Lord, and also I got it, that she's here under these circumstances. And the Lord said, stand her up. And so this angel got underneath me and just stood me right up. And, you know, when we're under circumstances, we're really out of, we're out of who we could be. We're out of living the way that heaven would have us live. And once I stood up, I was like, wow. And I could see Jesus. He was at the top of this mountain, and he was glorious and beautiful and shining and filled with strength and purpose and just looking at God. You know, when you look at God, you know who you are, and you feel there's nothing you can't do. I can do everything through Christ who's going to strengthen me. When my eyes are on him, I know I can do it. And he wanted me to come to him. I was so excited. I was like, okay, great. And that's when I noticed I had on a wedding dress. But my wedding dress was kind of dirty from having been underneath all those circumstances. And I was like, oh, I don't want to come to the Lord this way. But I noticed other people, other believers, they were walking to God. And some people were taking like a more direct route. And my angel was trying to convince me to go a long way, to take, it looked like it was dipping down. Like, why would I go that way? But the thing that I know about my angel, and that we can count on for the angels that God sends for help, is that these angels obey God. So my angel knows that the Lord had asked me to come, and so my angel cannot disobey God. He's there to help me, and I know that whenever I'm in the vision, and I want to always remember that God sends angels to help us complete his will for us. And so I followed the angel in a different path, to go like down and around. And while I was doing that, going down and around, I saw the realities, kind of like a hologram is the only thing that I can explain it. I can be in two places at one time, but it's hard for my eyes to see both places at one time. I saw people who were in need of like a well. They needed drinking water. And because I was on this bridal march, you think about when a young woman gets married, she walks down the aisle to her husband. Well, imagine if your walk was to walk through a village to get to your husband, or to walk through a city. What if it was walking across the state? Or in this case, what if it's walking across your life knowing that God is watching you? And I knew that he loves me, and I knew that he loves these people, and that if they only knew him, if this crowd only knew him, not only would they start their own bridal march, but it would make me happy, and more than that, it would make Jesus so happy on this wedding march that I'm walking on. And so I prayed to Jesus, and I asked him for the gift, and he gave the people the water. Hallelujah. And then, you know, walked to the next town, and people need healing. And as I was walking, the angel wanted me to look at my dress. Not only was it getting brighter and more brilliant, it was having beautiful appliques applied to it, and lace, and sequins and pearls. I mean, this dress was becoming so stunning. The longer that I walked and the more that I served God, the more brilliant that dress became. Oh my goodness, John. Once I understood the reason why the angel was telling me to go this way is because it really does make me such a brilliant bride of Christ. And that's who I want to be. That's an identity that we really want. The Lord has called us his brides. We're going to rule and reign with him. He wants us to come and sit with him at the supper of the Lamb. I mean, he is the bridegroom, and hallelujah. I mean, once we understand that our life really does matter, and that he's watching us, and that we're on our way to him, that's where we're going. And anything that we're asking him along this bridal march, he'll give it. Not only because he's good and benevolent, but because we're asking for things that's in accordance with his heart. And I want that. The more that I walk on this bridal march, the more that I believe I am becoming the bride of Christ, that he's going to be so pleased with me. I believe when I get there, his smile will tell me what it is he's getting ready to say. You know, we all long to hear, well done, good and faithful servant. And it's not something we can put off to the last minute. That's something that we have to desire today. I want to hear him say to me, well done, good and faithful servant. And so what is that? What would that look like for today? And that's forefront in my mind. I want to live today pleasing Jesus. And we're all on that bridal march. Once we give our life to Christ, that's what we're doing. And when we can see it that way, that our angel may be taking us into places that are, you know, not the direct path. It's not the direct path, but that as our angel is taking us there, it's so that we can become stunning. And I want people to look at me and say, wow, look at how much she loves God. I want that. I want people to say that about me. And so I agree with God and with the plan that he has for my life and the situations that I walk through. I just make sure that I'm never under those circumstances. And that vision has taught me so much about how to live, start out living today, start out living, you know, in this morning. How am I going to live today? And by the time the night comes, I can be pleased that I've set my heart. I want to be the bride of Christ today. I want to help others meet him. I want to be that kind of bride, benevolent and good, just like he is. And working out every spot and wrinkle out of my life. So that vision has taught me so much about my life. Are we doing okay, John? Is this good?
Absolutely.
Oh, good. Good. And another part about heaven that I just love is who we are in heaven. You know, there are so many truths about who we are and why God has us go the way that he has us go. And really, a lot of that is for he wants us to shine. God sets us up so that we can shine. And his desire is to put gems and jewels for us in our crowns so that we're something to lay at his feet. And excuse me. When my girls were small, they used to like to make dinner for Mike. Now they were little, they weren't a lot of help as far as dinner goes, but they wanted to make the brownies. So I would put everything in the bowl. They would stir it one or two times, And, buddy, when those brownies were set out on the table all done, they took all the credit, right? They would tell their daddy, I made those brownies. And the reason why I share that is that's the way we are with God. He puts everything together for us. We stir it a couple times, and when it comes out looking fantastic, it's like, God, look what we did. When in reality, you know, God is like that good, good Father that just, he wants us to shine. And, you know, a vision that taught me that God is not only paying attention to, but situations that he puts us in. I call it the parade because I got to go to a parade in heaven. And, you know, it was one of those family time events. And when I got to heaven, I have friends who are with me in heaven. I know them when I get to heaven, but when I'm here, I can't tell you their names, but they're friends in heaven, and they're with me to remind me to pay attention because heaven is so amazingly beautiful. Everything is so stunning and alive that it's easy to get just captivated at watching something and miss something else. So they're there to just kind of help me focus because I'm there so that I can bring a truth back and implement it in my life and then tell others. So in this vision, when I got to heaven, they said, you know, she's here. She's never seen the parade. And I had no idea what they were talking about. I did understand that the scripture verse that I was learning was the scripture verse that says, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. So that was the scripture that was over the vision that I was encountering. And so in heaven, people fly. They fly straight up and down off the ground. And you can be really tall in heaven because you can fly off the ground, you know, 1 inch, 1 foot, 10 feet. You can fly off the ground. And your height is determined by your obedience to Christ. And so is your brightness. Your brightness in heaven is determined by your love and obedience to Christ. And I like to make sure that people understand something. You know, a lot of people say, I love Jesus, but they don't obey Jesus. And that's not the kind of love that Jesus is asking for. You can call that infatuation. You can call that a lot of things, but it's not the love that God measures, that he considers faithful love, because he said, if you love me, you obey me. And if you obey Christ, not only can you be tall, but you can also be very bright. So the brightness, the people were there and they're flying, but I couldn't fly. So the rocks had to move me. And they love to move you like a people mover at the airport. You know, they just kind of moved me forward because I couldn't fly. The reason why I can't fly is because my body is still alive on the earth. So they moved me, but my friends were moving people out of the way. And I came and stood at the street, and the man on my left, I felt something in him that I had never felt in heaven before, and it was regret. And I thought, wow, I never felt that before. You know, it wasn't overwhelming or anything like that, but it wasn't something that I was used to. And I looked down in this vision at the street in heaven. Actually, first I looked up, but since I'm on the street, I looked at the street in heaven, and I had always thought that the street was supposed to be bricks made out of gold. That's what I thought it was supposed to be, bricks made out of gold. But when I looked down at this street in heaven, it wasn't like that at all. It was actually real smooth, like a piece of glass. And if you can imagine two pieces of glass, maybe, I don't know, maybe a foot apart, and the inside of this glass filled with, and what it was filled with was gold that moved like an ocean. It was like I was watching an ocean of gold move around in waves, and it was stunning. It was alive. This thing was moving everywhere. If you didn't do anything else, you could stand there all day watching this beautiful gold ocean street. And my friends, whenever I'd get like I said, captivated. They were like, pay attention, pay attention. I was like, okay, okay. Well, I was looking up, which was first, but I was looking up, and there was liquid drops of love were coming out of the sky, and they weren't just falling. They were coming down, spinning like confetti. But they weren't just falling straight. They were zigzagging. They had a purpose of where they were going. They were looking for who they were being sent to. And these so many drops of liquid love would fall on you and absorb into you, not get you wet, but like absorb into you and cause you to giggle. Now I have small grandchildren, and the 1 and 2 and 3 year olds, when you chase them, they will just pure giggle. And when they giggle, you laugh. And that's the way it is. I mean, when these liquid drops of love would hit us, we would giggle because we are the children of God. And somebody else's giggle would cause you to laugh. And it was just so delightful and so encouraging. And laughter is great, great fun. And so, you know, these liquid drops of love, you couldn't tell where they were going to go. I don't think I got one right. As they would come down, I was watching, where were they going? I don't think I'd get one right. And I was just amazed at this confetti, this liquid love confetti falling out of the sky. And my friends would be like, pay attention, pay attention. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. I'm here for a reason. And then in the parade, there was people marching. And you could tell what these people had done. So it was in honor of a day. It was a day before I was born. So, you know, pick some Monday before I was born. And whatever. These people were marching in the parade. God had lined all these people up because they had been alive that day. And they had served God. And we all knew what they had done. All these beautiful people dressed in time period of clothes that they like. And, you know, I say the introverts are still introverted, however they talk a little more, and the extroverts are still extroverted, however they talk a little less. And they were all marching in the parade, and there was a woman there. She was marching because she had baked a cake. You see, she had heard about a family that had already miscarried 2 babies. And they were pregnant again. And so she had baked a cake in celebration. And she was going to pray for this family. That's all that she had done, was bake the cake. But to God, it was such a show of his great love. And it had meant so much to those people that she was standing with them in the love of God, that it deserved to be walking in this parade with great honor. It was like, wow. And then there was a man, he was walking in the parade, and what he had done was he was driving down the road and praying in tongues. He's driving down this road, and then so he saw somebody and they needed their tire changed. So he stopped to change their tire with the love of God, got their tire all changed, and they went on their way. But to God, it was seen as something so honorable and so loving that this man had helped with the love of Christ. So much so that God said this man deserved to walk in this parade with such great honor. And it was exciting to see all the people in acts of love that they had done for God. You know, the scriptures teach that even if you give a cold cup of water in his name, these people had done not a cold cup of water, but they had done what they could. And to God, it was so wonderful. He counted it so wonderful that he put him in his parade. And so they kept marching. And my friends are like, pay attention. And you could hear this horse before you could see him. The horse was coming down the road. It was the Lord's horse. He only has one. This horse is huge. He's white. He's got big, big, big wings. And he could do a little dance. He was very happy to be the Lord's horse. And he could do this little dance as he would come down the road. And what he would say is, I'm the Lord's horse. I'm the Lord's horse. And when he would say it, the people in the parade would answer. And, you know, you could answer, I'm the Lord's warrior. I'm the Lord's chef. My favorite is, I'm the Lord's favorite one. And I hope that you can say that too. But the horse, when the horse would call out his identity in God, it caused this moving that would cause the people to respond with who you are, who they are in God. And you know that principle works on the earth. If we call out who we are in God, it causes that same shaking. If I tell you, you know, I'm the Lord's favorite daughter, it causes, like, wait a minute, no, I'm his favorite daughter. Well, good. I mean, we need to call out more and more who we are in God, because as we do that, it causes the Christians around us to take notice of who God has made them to be. And it was really fun. That horse is a lot of fun. And he had this material coming off of him, and there were leaps, L-E-A-F, leaps attached to the hem, the hems of this garment. And these leaves sent out these like little mini earthquakes. And I watched, these leaves were really stunning, that they could just stay there and not die and just like pinch this garment. And they were for the healing of the nations, these little tremors that would go out. It was all so exciting watching it. And the horse walked by, and all of a sudden, the man on my left, he was able to join the parade. You see, he had been alive that day, but he hadn't done anything deserving of walking in the front of the parade, because he didn't love God. He didn't love God with acts of service of any kind, so he didn't walk in the front of the parade. However, he was alive that day, and our great God was doing a really deep work in him that had not been revealed yet. And so the man got to walk in the back of the parade because of God's greatness in turning him into a man that very soon you'll be seeing him walking in the front of the parade, because, of course, he's in heaven. And I got it. I mean, while I was looking at this whole thing, I got it. And what I knew is, with every day of my life, I want to do acts for God. They don't have to be huge acts, but I want to love people. I want to love others with the love of God that's in me, because it brings great honor to Jesus. It so pleases his heart. Because, you know, John, there'll be many, many days where I walk in the back of that parade because I'm a work, a hidden work, because of God's greatness that's coming out of me. I know that. But, oh, I'd much rather walk in the front of the parade. And then my friends were standing there, and they were, you know, they were like, pay attention, see Jesus. And I said, no, I didn't see Jesus. Where was he? Where is he? And they said, Laurie, he's on his horse. You know, I loved watching the horse dance and the garment with the leaves and the spinning droplets and the street of gold waves. People, I mean, I loved all of it, but I had not seen Jesus, and that's what I came to heaven for. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. The Lord, it's all about the Lord. I was like, oh, man. And so the plan was to run me along the side of the parade route there on that street and get me in front of the horse, so I could turn around and look back up and see Jesus, see the face of Jesus. And so that was the plan. I was excited about the plan, and be still, I couldn't fly, so the rock started moving me in that direction. And that's when I looked up, and John, I saw Jesus from his back, the back, and what I saw changed my life. First let me tell parts that I saw. So first, I only saw his frame, but what I saw was that material that the leaves were clinging to was his cloak. His cloak sat around his shoulders, came down his shoulders, down his horse, and touched the ground. It's coming from Jesus. It's coming from his power and his authority, the healing of the nations. And of course the leaves would do whatever God told them to do. And it was stunning to see the majesty of our God riding on his horse. And it's a huge horse, and he's a regular sized guy. And you think, well, that horse is way too big. But I have to tell you, that horse, the man sitting on that horse, has so much strength inside of him. Jesus has so much strength inside of him that horse is not too big. Just one small word or understanding from Jesus, and that horse will do whatever it is that God wants him to do. Just remarkable. It's just remarkable. And the confetti, those liquid drops of love, were actually coming out of the top of the Lord's crown, and it was shooting out everywhere. So the reason why these little liquid drops of love didn't just fall, that they were on a purpose, that they were coming from God. His thoughts towards his people were sending out all this love to let them know how important and how special to him they are. And of course it was spinning, and it was joy when it got to the people. When it got to me, all it could do was just cause you to giggle. I mean, just great joy coming from God. Of course it would be. Of course it would. And all those things were beautiful, but the most important thing that I saw put me on the ground in heaven. And nothing has been able to stop me in heaven except in this vision. I mean, you know, in heaven you do what you're supposed to do. The angels help you go, you know. But what I saw dropped me, and this worship came out of me, this noise. Because in heaven, you don't have to sing lots of phrases or melodies. You don't have to have a preset of lyrics that you're going to sing. You can sing with a very special sound that's as unique as your fingerprint, right? So the sound comes out of you, and everybody has a sound, and we make this beautiful music together. It's very harmonious, everyone making their sound. But when I saw Jesus, and what I saw caused me to fall in heaven, the rocks could not move me because my whole heart was in worship. My whole heart was willing to say that this is our God, this beautiful man, this majestic Lord, who did everything to take care of us on this day, is the center of this is the day that the Lord has made. And us rejoicing and being glad in it is because our God paid everything. What I saw was his crown. And things in heaven are different than things here. You can see two things at one time. And the only way that I can try and explain that is like a hologram picture. If you have a hologram picture and you look at it, you might see the lady looking to the left. But then you move the picture just a little bit and you can see the lady looking to the right. And it's like, how did it do that? Well, in a similar kind of way, heaven's like that. It has two things at one time happening, and you can see two elements of the same thing. So what I saw was his crown. So I saw his crown, it was a crown of light, amazing light, and knowing that he is the source of all light, and it's because of his goodness and because of his benevolence that there can be no darkness there, because Jesus is light. Crown is just a resemblance, it shows his authority, where there can be no darkness because of the king who is light. But also, his crown is a crown made out of thorns. And it was shocking to me to see first that God chooses to wear a crown of thorns. And this reality hit me that, you know, I thought, well, the cross was done. That was here on earth. You know, that was this gruesome thing that he had to do. No, the cross is such a part of heaven. And because of what Jesus did on that cross, because of the love that he poured out there, because of this crown that he wore, it resembles the great king who spends everything for his people. He spent everything, every drop of his blood, all of his body was exposed. You know, Jesus hung on the cross naked with his skin dripping off of him on his back that was just beaten. And there he is. This king who still identifies for his people. He's the king of his people. And he wears that crown. There's no doubt how much does he love us. There's no doubt of how far was he willing to go for us. That's our God, the God that still wears the crown. He is not ashamed of what it is that he did, and neither should we be. You know, the scriptures say, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we need to remind people of that. The cross belongs in the church. And there's many churches, they don't have a cross in the church. It's like, well, don't you understand? Our king is the king of the cross. Our king is the king who wears, he's the only one who wears the crown of thorns as an example. And, you know, that whole parade, even though God had put all these people who'd done acts of love and kindness for him in front, and then he put all these people behind him that are this hidden work, that he's doing something great in their hearts, the truth is that the most important thing, no wonder the horse was dancing, because who he's carrying is the most important person of the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And no one would be in heaven without this king. All would be lost because all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And when I saw that, when I saw our king, the king who still identifies with his people, the king who loves us so much that where he is, this king of light, there can be no darkness. And he's the one who purchased us for God. He's the one who wants us with him. I fell down in heaven and I just cried. And I cried and I let the sound come out of me of great worship. And I understood when we get to that place where we will open our heart in wholehearted worship. It's got to be wholehearted worship. I'm not talking about just playing a song a long time that we like. I'm talking about getting the revelation of who is this king who loves us. And when we let that sink in and we give wholehearted worship to this king, he connects us to him in such a way that we get it. That no matter what happened today, Jesus Christ is the king of today. And I don't know every good thing that he was doing today and all the stuff behind the scenes that Jesus was working on today, but he was. And he is, and he's going to keep doing it for the babies that are being born today, for the people that today is their last day. This is the only, you know, today's their last day. God is working for them. And he's created this wonderful parade, that will let us know that he's not ashamed. He's not ashamed of what he did. And, oh, heaven help us. We cannot be ashamed of what God did. We should not be ashamed of the blood that he shed because it's the greatest act of love that's ever been done for God to purchase men. Oh, isn't it exciting what he's done for us, John? I worked myself up. I'm just so excited again. I feel that wholehearted worship for Jesus.
Oh, amen. Praise God. Now, I every time I ever, it just makes you so hungry, you know. It's in a kind of paradox like way, it actually makes you kind of like, I'm like dreading going back to work tomorrow. I just want to go home. I know a lot of the listeners of the program, I get emails from people and they're just like, oh my goodness, because, you know, A lot of folks are in some pretty difficult situations, you know, right now especially. And so they're, you know, the more hard their lives are, the more hungry they are to go home, you know. And it just makes me homesick. I know a lot of people that write me all the time, and they're so homesick, you know, to get back, you know, get back to our home, you know, to be able to, like, I had this a niece of mine. Oh, this is nothing like what you've gone through, but I had a niece of mine, and she said, I don't remember if she was in a hospital or sick or whatever happened. I don't remember the details, but she did say to me, she said, Johnny, did I ever tell you that I was taken to heaven? And I said, no. And she says, I wasn't there very long, but what I remember was when I got there, when I was there, it felt like a ton of logs had been lifted off of my shoulder. She explained that the oppression, the depth of the oppression that we experience on a daily basis, we just don't even understand it. It is really, really bad. And she said, when I felt that release, it was the most incredible ecstasy I've ever felt in my life. And she, you know, I was like, wow. I mean, you hear so many different people have different ways of expressing things that they've experienced and seen. And just that simple concept of realizing how heavily oppressed we are in this, I don't know, let's just call it a realm of existence here on the earth, and how glorious it is. I mean, even the scripture, even in the little prayer at the end of Jude, where it says, now to him, Jesus, who is able to keep us from stumbling and present us faultless before the presence of God's glory with exceeding joy. The very words exceeding joy are, how do you quantify that? You know what I mean? I mean, it's just got to be absolutely mind-blowing. I just think, oh, I just want to go home. I can't wait. So when you come on the show and you're sharing anything, and you just talked about, we have a lady now. I don't think she's listening to this program, so I'm going to have to remind her to listen. She text messages me now and then, and she is the only other person that knew that animals talked in heaven. Now, I know that the Book of Jubilees mentions that the animals talked in Hebrew. And Jubilees is actually mentioned in the 66 book canon. And I forget, somebody had been there and they said, when an animal talks in heaven, they don't really talk like we talk, you know. They talk more like little kids, you know, like a little three-year-old, like, I would like to go into a little bitty yum-yum kind of thing, you know what I mean? I was like, and I look at my dogs right now, and I'm kind of thinking to myself, because, you know, you take – it's hard to lose, whether it's a family member or a pet or whatever. It's really hard because we're grieving. It's our loss. But to recognize that even our own pets are – that God loves us so much that even our own pets are waiting for us to arrive. You know, it's just – I guess it makes it all worthwhile, you know?
I agree. I have people ask me, will pets go to heaven? And I was always told, no, your pets don't go to heaven. So that's, I would grieve terrible when one of my pets would die. But that's not true. When I was in heaven, I saw many pets in heaven. In fact, I saw my little dog from when I was a little girl. She got hit by a car. Her name is Snowball, and she is there. And the qualifications for the pets are if you loved and cared for that pet, you know. So if you loved and took care of that pet, that pet will be in heaven. Hallelujah. However, you know, there are pets that are in heaven, but their owners are in hell, because the qualifying thing for people to get to heaven is Jesus is the only way. Jesus is the only way to the Father in heaven, and there is no other way. And so you may have loved and cared for your dog, your cat, your rabbit can go to heaven, because the qualifying thing for them is very different. But I saw there were pets in heaven, and their earthly owners were in hell. And it was very shocking. I also saw, I toured a mansion in heaven. And I was very impressed, John, with so there were bookshelves in this person's mansion, lots of bookshelves and shelves and trinkets. I love going somewhere and looking at people's pictures and what type of treasures do people save. And there were all kinds of treasures there. And when I asked the Lord, I wanted to meet the man that he loved so much with all these treasures. Jesus was very sad, because even though he had prepared this place for this man, that man had never chosen God. And so it stands.
What did the man do? What went wrong? Why would the Lord? I mean, this matches. Now, I'm not. This is not a debate. I'm aligning what you saw and experienced with testimonies of other people that have been to heaven, and what you're saying aligns. But what happened with this particular guy? Where did he go wrong?
Right. You know, I mean, I'm not sure where that man went wrong. But what I saw was trinkets that God had saved for this man, baseball gloves. So I saw baseball gloves from the time this man was little, or it would have been a little boy. I saw child-sized baseball gloves and baseballs. I saw all kinds of baseballs, like when people came to heaven, important baseball people, Jesus had them sign the baseball for this man. You know, here, and you've got this player, and you've got this one. And there were model cars waiting to be built there. You know, you glue them together and that kind of stuff. So there were all kinds of trinkets and things that Jesus wanted to do with this man. And it stands as Jesus' legacy of love for this person. And that person never came to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And you know, I mean, you have to give everything to God. He gets to be your everything. And if he's not, he's not. And this man never came. He never came to Jesus. And so even though God had all these trinkets prepared for him, it was very shocking to see how God had at every turn, he knew this man and he wanted this man to be with him. And how many times had God reached out with his love to try and rescue this man? Because, you know, as you know, all people have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Without the saving blood of Jesus Christ, everybody would go to hell, everybody. And so that's why it's so important that we let people know, look, if you're not right with God, you're headed to hell now.
Oh, yeah, no, and plus everything that you're saying is 100% scripturally aligned. Psalm 139:16 says that, you know, all of our moments were written in books even before we were born, you know, the works that we were to walk in, you know. And then you've got the sister verse of that, which is Ephesians 2:10, which says essentially the same thing in the New Testament. So, yeah, I mean, it aligns perfectly. It's just kind of heartbreaking. There was one person that was taken to heaven that was flying over heaven and saw with an angel and saw mansions where the angels had stopped working on the mansions. And she asked, why aren't they continuing the work? And evidently at that time, the mansions that were being built for that individual, that person had backslidden and turned away from the Lord. And so at that point, the angel stopped working. And I was like, wow. So, yeah, what you're seeing, this whole real-time thing, you know, as a person is working out their own salvation with fear and trembling and, you know, and going through the sanctification process, you know, it's heartbreaking to even imagine someone not making it, you know, and it's like, it's, but you know, the thing I think it's glorious. I think for us though, is that we live in a time right now where, well, it's a little hard to predict the time, really. I mean, we see the things that are happening around the earth. But if things continue to progress in the general direction from an earthly, you know, things are getting pretty creepy. Things are getting pretty dark out there. And they're not getting lighter. They're getting darker and darker and darker and darker. And that's a good thing because because the body of Christ rises in the light. We are the light. So the darker things become, the more light we become. And that gives us even more opportunity to go out and witness and touch people's lives. You know, and this, by the way, is true historically throughout thousands of years of time. The most oppressed civilizations ever were the ones that had the greatest increase in Christianity. Christianity is just absolutely burgeoning in Iran right now. People are coming to Christ like crazy. They're having dreams and visions of them. The churches are filling up there. The same thing happened in China. The biggest outbreak of Christianity, they went from like 1 million when they were under the most oppression in China. They went from 1 million believers while the missionaries were there. The missionaries got kicked out and they were being slaughtered. When the missionaries went back, they didn't know if there were going to be any Christians left. And it turned out they went from 1 million to 30 million in the time under the oppression. So, you know, as we watch the things around us in dismay getting darker, these are actually opportunities for us. Praise God to be able – because, you know, when people are going through hard times, that's when they want to hear. I think the biggest mistake we make sometimes is assuming someone doesn't want to hear. And the simplest thing we can offer somebody is to pray for them. When a person is hurting, when they're in a wheelchair, when they're limping, it's amazing. Even when they're unbelievers, they're just so tired of being sick. They're very receptive to prayer, and it opens up an opportunity for us to be able to witness to them, even when we assume that they don't want anything to do with us. And oftentimes it's amazing. They do. I've had that happen to me, and I was like, wow. And the person was like, yes, please. I would love it if you would pray for me. I was like, this is great. That's a wonderful thing to do, you know, just to ask somebody if you can pray for them.
Oh, I agree wholeheartedly. And so on Saturdays, I lead an outreach. I train evangelists, and we go out on Saturdays. Yesterday, we were doing a door-to-door outreach, and I was training another evangelist, and this is what he noticed. He said, "Laurie, you just don't stop talking." He's like, you know, they're not interested in what you have to say. Because people will say something like, no, I'm fine. And he goes, you just keep talking. He's like, you act like they invited you to share more. That's what you act like. He's like, did you hear them when they said they're not interested? And I said, yeah, I heard them. But, you know, our approach has to be, look, I have the living God inside of me, and you really need him. And I may never see you again. And I have to try. I have to keep trying. At night, I can go to sleep knowing that I tried. So many times, I'm not interested. It changes. It changes if we would just take the time and do like what you're saying, just to stop and ask, let me pray for you. And when we ask someone, can I pray for you? And they say, yes, what they're expecting is for you to go home and pray for them. They're not expecting you to pray right now. And if you'll just be bold and pray out loud, you know, don't go weird on them. Don't close your eyes. Don't bow your head. Just look at them and pray and talk to Jesus real normal. And these people will be shocked that you talk to Jesus like he's alive. I hear that all the time. You're talking to Jesus like he's alive. That's because he is, and he's listening, and he cares. And believe, when you pray for someone, that they will get out of that wheelchair. Then ask them, how are you feeling? Let's try it. Can you get out of the wheelchair? Because you will be surprised. I mean, in my own in my own time, I have prayed for people and saw remarkable things. I remember when I prayed for this lady, she had been in her wheelchair for years. Her son had to pick her up and carry her every morning and night up and down the stairs because they lived in a two-story and his mom could not walk. When we prayed and God said, get that lady out of that wheelchair, she started running around the church that night. And the whole church who knew her started running around with her. Buddy, it was such a happy day. I mean, she ran out of energy quick because she's not used to running. Well, the next day we put her on the stage at the outreach and people came to Christ because they knew her. They knew that lady can't walk. And it's just because when we will pray for people, our God is still the miracle-working God that we know him to be of the Bible. He is that God today. And he desires to show people his love. And the Father loves to show the glory on his Son. You know, it's like God won't share his glory with another. That's because there is not another that has any glory like the Lord. I mean, there's no comparison between I pray for people, nothing happens. But I pray and ask God to get involved. And when Jesus gets involved, amazing things. And we just got to expect it. And so don't stop talking. Treat people with an urgency because you don't know. You may never see them again. And what if you're it? What if you're the one that your love for God is the love that will change that heart? So just keep talking. It's like, well, didn't you hear them say they don't want to talk to you anymore? And when people say that, you know, I just don't want to talk to you anymore. And I say, really? I would love to get to know you better because God knows you so well and he really wants you. You know, stuff like that. People soften. You know, our gift makes room for us, the scriptures say, and I believe that gift that we want to make room for is the Holy Spirit. Just let him have his way. And he does, he desires to save people more. It is his perfect will, we know, for no one to perish. So if we can just keep them talking a little bit longer. Yesterday, we'd finished with a woman and we'd shut the door. And she lived on the corner, so we walked around, and now we're at her garage. She flips open the garage door. She goes, hey, you two, come back here. She's like, I have some more I want to talk to you about. And I thought, look at there. We had only walked partway around, and this lady really had more to say, more questions to find out about God. And it was like, we just planted a few seeds, but those seeds can, in no time at all, bring glory to God. One of my favorite scriptures is if we would lift the Lord high, if we would lift him high, then he would draw men and women to himself. And that's what we desire for our family and our friends and our neighbors, our coworkers, and how we do it, how we lift God high, lift the name of Jesus. Just start talking about him. Just start sharing all the good things that he's done. And he will draw men and women to himself because he's not a man that he should lie. I mean, our God will do everything that he said he would do in the Bible. We can count on it and just trust him. Amen?
Yeah, and the other thing that I think is amazing too, which, so, you know, I was, you know, brought up, you know, in a, you know, Pentecostal tongue speaking, spirit filled, Holy Spirit bring down multiple times a week, special services, the whole deal, you know, me cleaning houses, chasing demons, spiritual warfare, the whole deal. That was how I was brought up my whole life. And so to me, it's, you know, going into like, you know, divine healing, you know, Smith Wigglesworth type, you know, events and stuff like that, and seeing people jump out of wheelchairs and people, you know, blind eye see and A.A. Allen type stuff. That was my life. I mean, I spent 12, 15 years. That was a regular thing for me. Now, but my point is this. I believed, for no good reason, and at the time I didn't really know the Bible very well, but I just believed that if it didn't happen like right away, like a miracle, that it would never happen. That's just what I thought. I just figured, oh, okay, well, that person didn't receive their healing. And the vast majority of Christians actually do believe that. But that isn't reality. Reality is that you can pray for somebody and it can start they can receive their healing 2 months later, 3 months later. I know a person that was dying of cancer that had several believers circle around her and pray for her in a service, and she did not receive her healing until 6 months later, and she was totally cured. Now she just tours around the world and gives her testimony. So, you know, we make oftentimes, because when you look in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, okay, about the nine gifts of the Holy Spirit, you see that there is a gift of healing, and then you see that there is a gift of miracles, right? But what you see in Mark 16, 18 is it says that these things will follow those who believe. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. It doesn't say anything about it happening miraculously. So, you know, my point is to add on to your point, which is don't not pray for somebody and get discouraged, because that's what happens. Well, that's what happens. The devil jumps in. He makes you think things. Oh, you know, you don't have enough faith, this, that, and the other thing. The person thinks you're, you know, messed up in the head kind of thing. And it brings you down. You get depressed. You're like bummed out. Oh, you know, and then you don't want to do it again. And that's just the wrong way to look at things. If you have an opportunity to pray, the Lord will use that power. That it doesn't have to be a miraculous event for it to be a major life-changing, eternity-saving event for that individual. Just the fact that you offered to do it in the first place, that may be their very first time they've been around anybody that acted out of faith. They may have never seen it before, and then they get curious and the Lord calls them. Next thing you know, they're going to a church, or maybe they do receive their healing later. So yeah,
amen.
I praise God for what you're saying. I just love what you're saying right now, because it's getting me pumped. It makes me want to, you know, once things calm down with the pandemic and stuff like that, I don't know if they, you know, what's going to happen. None of us do. We're just kind of waiting out the situation, but you know, I know that even when I go out to dinner, I love to use current events because of the show to start the conversation. I'll be sitting in the table having some chicken wings or whatever, or hamburger, and I'll look over and I'll be like, man, this pandemic thing, boy, this is really weird. This is almost like something right out of the Bible, isn't it? You know, that's what I'll say to the person across the table. And they kind of look at me and they're going like, you know, you're right. It is kind of like out of the Bible. I went to some, I don't remember what it was, but it was some kind of affair or something. And these people had a little, it was a husband and wife team. And I said, have you guys noticed how many earthquakes there have been lately? There sure have been a lot of earthquakes, haven't there? And they're like, you know, you're right. There has been a lot of earthquakes. I said, man, that sounds awful biblical to me. And then I'll just walk around, you know, because you're planting these little seeds, you know. I love doing that.
I agree. You know, if there's somebody in front of me, if there's somebody standing with me, I think, well, these people, I got to just be sure these people, that they get to meet and love Jesus today. So I just so agree with you. Oh, this has been so much fun tonight. Thank you.
Oh, it has been. Praise God. It's got me pumped now. I'm, you know, if it wasn't dark here in lovely Tampa, Florida right now, I'd be half tempted to go around and look for somebody. Hallelujah. But anyway, thank you so much, Sister Lori, for coming on. What an exciting, I mean, my goodness, the confirmations and everything, man, they just line up beautifully. I've got to get in contact with Sister Carol up in Michigan, because she's a retired vet, and boy, anybody who confirms pets in heaven, boy, she's on fire. So I'll have to let her know. She definitely has to listen to the program. But anyway, did you want to go ahead and close with a prayer for us tonight real quick?
Oh, I would love that. You know, if you don't know this Jesus that we're talking about, he wants you to know him. And so I want to just pray for you first, that if you want Jesus to come into your heart, if you want to be a believer, what you need to do is to believe that Jesus is who we say he is. He is the amazing God. He is God, and he died for your sins. And if you believe that in your heart, and you would let God know that you're sorry for your sin, and you need to repent of that sin, turn away from it. If you're willing to do that, and these aren't just words, if you're willing to do that, God wants you with him. And so for for you if you'd pray this prayer with me. Jesus, I believe that you're God. I want you to come and take over my life. I want to be your servant. I want to spend eternity in heaven with you. God, I believe that because I am repenting, you would receive me as your child, and as such, I can live my life now knowing that I will go to heaven. I'm going to try hard, God, to know you better. I'm going to go to find a good church. I'm going to get involved. I will learn about you. Thank you, God. And, Lord, for everybody else, I want to pray, God, that you would keep us strong, keep us sharp. Lord, help us lift your name high so that you can draw men and women to yourself. Jesus, we want to be the servants that you can be proud of. We want to hear, well done, good and faithful servant. Jesus, we want to be the people who can march in the parade because our acts of love are everywhere. God, we ask you that that on our last breath that we'll see you smile so that we will hear, well done. God, I pray for my brothers and sisters right now. You're not a respecter of persons. And so I ask, God, everybody wants to go to heaven. Would you bless them, God? It's not because they're special. It's because you'd make them responsible. And so, God, hand out your visions and make more of your children responsible so that many can know what heaven's like and we can live our life that way. Pray these things in the mighty name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Thank you so much, Sister Laurie, for coming on the program. And again, folks, I had to shorten the title of the program but the actual book that she has out that has like tons of more stuff in it is Encountering Heaven, 15 Supernatural Visions of Heaven That Will Change Your Life Forever with Laurie Ditto. And praise God. I'm so glad that you took the time to put that book together. And I just know it's going to bless so many people. Thank you, Laurie. Did you want to share, do you have a website people can go to get in touch with you?
I do. The name of it is myfathersreputation.com. Myfathersreputation.com. And you can email me there. My email address is contact@myfathersreputation. And I look forward to hearing from you.
What was the first part of the email?
Contact?
You said current tech or something like that. I don't know I don't know how to spell that.
Contact.
Contact. Gotcha.
Yep.
Contact. And it's at my contact at my father's. Can you fill that in for me? Contact at my father's reputation.com, right?
That is correct. Thank you.
Awesome. Praise God. Thank you so much. Thank you for joining us. What a powerful program. God bless you all. We will see you this Wednesday, Lord willing. Pray for us all. Pray for the saints. Pray for the saints. Pray for God's strength. Pray for our faith to be increased. Pray for wisdom in these confusing days that we are in. Pray that we walk in the gifts of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, long suffering, gentleness, kindness, faithfulness, goodness, and especially, this is the hardest one, self-control. God bless you all. See you this coming Wednesday, 8 p.m. or 7 p.m., Lord willing. Thank you, Lori. God bless you. Good night, everyone.